Well, good morning to all of you gathered here. It's good to see you here. Good morning. We welcome any special guests among us and those here for Gem Sunday. It is a special day when we celebrate our young girls, our young women, God's gift to us. They are gems to us, and we celebrate what God is doing in their lives. And so we're going to invite them in shortly. And then we'll hear our call to worship. As the gems are coming in, let us say welcome to them. Welcome, girls. We're glad that you could be with us today, and you're going to lead part of the service for us. And we get to hear what the Gems program is doing and what you guys have been doing in your Gems meetings here in our church. So welcome to you and to your counselors. We're glad that you're with us today. So I'm going to read from 2 Corinthians chapter 4. Few verses as our call to worship. For God who said, "Let light shine out of darkness," he has made his light shine in our hearts to give us the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. But we have this treasure in jars of clay to show that this all-surpassing power is from God and not from us. It is written, "I believed, therefore I have spoken." With that same spirit of faith, we also believe and therefore speak. Because we know that the one who raised the Lord Jesus from the dead will also raise us with Jesus and present us with you in his presence. All this is for your benefit, so that the grace that is reaching more and more people may cause thanksgiving to overflow to the glory of God. It's our hope and prayer that our thanksgiving and joy may overflow as we remember that indeed Jesus Christ has been raised from the dead. And that victory of his over death is ours, if our faith is in him. Let's begin our service singing. We're going to sing the first song, "Only a Holy God." Please stand when the music plays.
Thank you.
one and only God, the God who loves us, the God who sent his Son, and the one who gave himself for us to save us from our sins, greets us. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord Jesus Christ, who gave himself for our sins to rescue us from the present evil age, according to the will of our God and Father, to whom be the glory forever and ever. Amen. We now sing Our God. Thank you.
morning. I'm just going to give a quick update on our GEMS year this year. This year at GEMS, we had about 12 girls coming regularly. We had three different age group classes, and we met some new friends, and we had some new kids join us this year in our younger class. We shared a lot of laughs and fun this year. Our theme this year was just Micah 6 verse 8. Typically, the club uses Micah 6 verse 8 as an overarching theme, and then they do another verse as the yearly theme, but this year the organization decided to just do Micah 6 verse 8. So this year, our girls learned what it means to act justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with God. We learned what God's truth is and how they can change and how they can show that to our ever-changing world. We thank you, our church family, for your consistent support of our club over the years, whether it be a monetary gift, a prayer, or volunteering to help lead our important ministry. So with that, our GEMS have a couple songs to sing, and we have a litany to do as well. And now we will do our litany. Okay. For 50 years, girls and women from generation to generation have been uniting their voices to recite Micah 6 verse 8 in their GEMS clubs. Whether their club is in Canada, the U.S., Uganda, or 13 other countries, it sounds like this. GEMS and GEMS leaders, what does the Lord require of us?
Act justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with our God. Micah 6.
This is who God is.
I am the Lord who exercises kindness, justice, and righteousness on earth. For in these I delight, declares the Lord.
In grateful response to who he is and what he's done for us through Jesus, we act, love, and walk.
We act justly by taking
Equipped with God's word and compelled by his love, these girls are making a difference as they act justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with God. Let's encourage them, pray for them, and join them, because Micah 6 verse 8 isn't just for girls and gems, it's for all. Are you ready?
For the Sunday school kids, come forward. Let's just bow our heads in a time of prayer. Let's pray. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for the gems and for their opportunity to lead us in worship this portion of the service, Lord. We thank you for the work that you are doing in their lives. We thank you, Lord, for the counselors and the junior leaders who have given up their time this year to help the girls grow in faith, grow closer to Jesus. We thank you, Lord, for the GEMS program. We ask that you bless it, not only here in our church, but wherever it is in the world, that girls would everywhere would meet the Savior. So bless them, Lord, we pray. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, all the Sunday school kids, pre-K to grade one, come to the front. One on the end. Oh, you guys can squish in there. What do you think? Yeah, you're going to be right in the middle. There you go. Right? Something fell down? Okay, I'll fix it for all the OCD people in the congregation. That includes me, but I don't see it because I'm behind it, right? So thank you for catching that. All right, you guys are going to go off to Sunday school. I'm glad to see a bigger group this week. So you're going to have lots of help when you do when we do the blessing, right? But before you go, let's do what we normally do. Let's pray once more, and then you guys can go off, okay? Heavenly Father, we thank you for these children. We thank you for their energy and their joy of life. We thank you, Lord, for how they bring us joy. And we watch them grow and do the things they do, Lord. We thank you for the gift of childhood. Some, they want to leave that behind quickly, but I pray, Lord, for them that you minister to them at their age and let them know that you love them, that you created them special to be your children, and may they grow in faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. And I pray that for all of us, Lord, gathered here or watching, that we may grow in the knowledge and faith in Jesus Christ, that we may come to know him as a personal Savior in a deep and profound way, that we would offer our lives to him, and service to him and to his kingdom. For Jesus Christ indeed is Lord and King over all creation. So help us, Lord, to surrender willingly to our Savior Jesus. And as we turn to his word, open our hearts to receive it, whether here in the sanctuary, Lord, or in the Sunday school room. We just pray that you bless us in this time. We pray it all in Jesus' name, for your honor and for your glory. Amen. All right, you can stand up now and face all the people. And the GEMS are right close. Look at that. Right. There, they're waving even. Nice. Okay, let's bless the children saying, "The Lord be with you." Oh, great. You guys were in unison too. Good job. You guys can go off to Sunday school. Okay. And as the kids and their teachers head out, I invite you to turn to Philippians, Paul's letter to the church in churches in Philippi. Philippians 2. Page 1827 in our Pew Bible, 1827. In the litany, there were several Bible passages that tie into this theme of acting or act justly, love mercy, walk humbly. The Bible, God gives us his word so that we will live as his children. And today's passage from Philippians in our Pew Bible, the title is Imitating Christ's Humility. This is just one passage of many that call us as believers in Jesus Christ to live a certain way. We're going to explore that just a bit. Philippians 2, verses 1 through 13. If you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any fellowship with the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and purpose. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility consider others better than yourselves. Each of you should look not only to your own interests, but also to the interests of others. Your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus, who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even death on a cross. Therefore God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Therefore, my dear friends, as you have always obeyed, not only in my presence, but now much more in my absence, continue to work out your salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who works in you to will and to act according to his good purpose. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So Paul is writing these words to a group of Christians. This letter that we have in our Bibles called Philippians, it was sent to the churches in the town, the city of Philippi. And the Christians in that city were facing a problem. At one time, they once looked like and they lived like everyone else in Philippi. They practiced the same religions, activities, and lifestyles of all the other people. They really fit in, and they were liked, and they were, in a sense, part of the crowd. But then they heard about the God of the Bible. They heard how they were sinners who were separated from God. And they also heard the gospel of Jesus Christ. They heard how Jesus came to forgive people of their sin, and the Christians in Philippi believed in Jesus as their Lord and Savior. And once they believed in Jesus, then they rejected the false gods and the false religions in Philippi, the gods of the Roman Empire. And that made them very different from the townspeople, and they stood out. The Christians became objects of bullying and abuse. Many lost their customers or their jobs. Many lost their friends, and even some lost their families. They were disliked. They were ostracized. And ostracized is an old word that means to be shunned. We use the term canceled today. The Christians in Philippi were canceled. They were regarded as nobodies. That was one of the problems that the Christians in Philippi faced from the outside. And Paul writes to the Christians there in that city to encourage them to not give in and to not give up. He says, suffering for being a follower of Jesus, that's normal. Being bullied for being a Christian, that is to be expected. Getting canceled for being a Christian is how the world treats Christians who are different. Paul tells the Christians that their allegiance must be to Jesus and not to society. And he encourages them to keep living for the Savior, the one who rescued them from their sin. But the Christians in Philippi, they also faced another problem. And this problem came from within, inside the church. For inside the church, the Christian community, there was competition to be most popular. Some Christians were trying to be the head of the pack. They wanted the best seats in the house when they gathered. They wanted the best food when they ate meals together. Some church people tried to prove that they were better Christians than everyone else in the church. And they were focused on how to meet their own interests at the expense of others. They were not acting justly or loving mercy or walking humbly with God. They were living for themselves. And they behaved just like the rest of society inside the church. And Paul has something to say to Christians who seek self-promotion within the church. He had a message for Christians wanting to bring glory unto themselves. And Paul says, stop doing it. Stop behaving like the world that says, step on anyone to get ahead, to get to the top. Stop thinking that you're number one and you're where it's at. That's what he means when he says in verses 3 and 4, do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves, not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interests of others. Selfish ambition is stepping on others to get ahead. Vain conceit is pride in self that makes you look down at others as less than you. What Paul instructs the Christians to do instead is to act justly towards one another and to love mercy by being kind and considerate of one another and to walk humbly like God demands of his children. Because inside the church, all Christians belong and are equally loved by God. Inside the church, all Christians are valued with equal worth in God's eyes. How much does God see our worth? Enough that Jesus Christ came to die for us. That's how valuable God's people are to him, and every one of them has that equal value. So there's to be no self-promotion or favoritism inside the church. There's to be no prideful competition inside the church. Paul's not addressing a new problem, sadly. When Jesus was on earth, he had a group of disciples. After some time, they started to see each other as competition. They wanted the best seat around the table. They wanted to be most liked by Jesus. We have a story in the Bible where two disciples were aiming to sit at his left and his right when he became king. They wanted the status of being closest to Jesus and more important than all the rest. Their behavior is what Paul calls selfish ambition and vain conceit. They were not acting justly or loving mercy or walking humbly with the Lord. Jesus told his disciples that to fit into his group, a person had to become the least. Jesus said his true followers are those who serve others. And Christ Jesus' followers, they do not seek to be served. No, true Christians put the needs and the interests of others ahead of themselves. To live this way is to act justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly like the Lord. Paul reminds the Christians in Philippi, and God reminds us through this letter that has been saved and recorded in the Bible, who our role model should be. Paul says, don't be like the world. Don't live like the world. Rather, they and us, we should live like the Lord Jesus. It's Jesus who modeled the life of acting justly, loving mercy, and walking humbly with God. Jesus came to save his people from sin. But he also showed how his people need to live as those who are saved from sin. One time, Jesus even washed his disciples' dirty, smelly feet to show them what the model of servanthood was like. In verses 5 through 11 of our passage, Paul describes how Jesus lived in order to accomplish salvation. Christ Jesus is God the Son who came to earth and he took on a human body, a body like yours and mine. He did not stop being God when he became Jesus Christ. But he did put aside his rights. He put aside his privileges as God when he was on earth. Even though he was God, Jesus said he came to serve and not to be served. As Paul says in verse 7, he took on the nature of a servant. And Christians are to have the same attitude, the same outlook as Jesus Christ. In order to serve the people that he came to save, Jesus made himself nothing. Jesus served by giving his life in place of sinners. As God the Son, he became human so that he could die. He said that was his purpose for coming. And by willingly dying, even though he was completely innocent, he gave up justice for himself. Jesus satisfied God's justice concerning our sin. Jesus suffered the greatest injustice the world will ever see in order to achieve the greatest act of justice on our behalf. If we believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, then Jesus has met God's justice requirement for us. Jesus coming to earth to live and to die in our place, that is him extending mercy to us. Mercy is not receiving the penalty or the punishment that you deserve. Jesus took our penalty. He took on our punishment. And by sending Jesus to do that, to take away our penalty for sin, our punishment, eternal wrath, God extends his mercy to each one of us. Jesus satisfied God's justice against our sin in mercy because he humbled himself. He humbled himself in a way that no other human has or ever could or will. And he humbled himself in obedience to God's salvation plan. In the Garden of Gethsemane, just hours before he died a horrible death, Jesus prayed. And as much as he did not want to suffer, he said, "Not my will, but yours be done." He humbly obeyed God's plan. He walked that path to the cross and to his death. Verses 9 through 11 describe how Jesus was then exalted after his supreme act of humility. Because he satisfied God's justice and was God's mercy to sinners, he achieved salvation for all who believe in him. And because he was successful, he was resurrected from the dead, and he is now ascended and is in heaven. The Lord Jesus Christ sits on God's throne right now. Christ Jesus is King over all creation. And Christians in heaven and here on earth glorify Jesus as Lord. Christians willingly glorify Jesus, and we willingly call him our Lord. But one day when the Lord Jesus returns, all humans will bow down before him. All will confess that he is Lord. One day when Jesus Christ returns, even his enemies will be forced to bow before him and to confess that he is Lord over all creation and that he is King over all creation. It will be too late for them, but every human being will confess Jesus Christ is Lord and bow before him. And so if you believe that Jesus is your Savior, then is he your Lord? And you bow before him. If Jesus is your Lord and Savior, have you surrendered your life to him as Lord and as King? If Jesus is our Lord, and because he is, for many of us, we need to obey him, and we need to follow him. When we do that, when we obey and follow him, then we glorify him, and we show to others in our community, in our family, in the world around us, that Jesus is our Lord. We serve not the gods of this age, not the motivations of society. We serve Jesus Christ. And people will see that in us. The Lord Jesus wants his followers to live like him. And that means we are to act justly, love mercy, and walk humbly, just like he did. We may have to give up our rights, especially if we're going to tell others in a world that doesn't want to hear about him, in a world that even outlaws speaking about Jesus and telling the gospel. We may have to give up justice for ourselves to live like Jesus. As I said, telling the gospel is banned. It's forbidden in many countries of the world. But Christians do it anyways. They tell others about Jesus. And when they do that, their rights are infringed upon, their comforts are taken away, they are abused, persecuted, and some are even killed. That's because some people don't want to hear that Jesus can save them from sin if they would only turn to him in repentance and seeking forgiveness. The unbelieving world may become hostile towards us. They may harm us. They may even try to cancel us. The Lord himself may send us to our enemies, people who don't like us, people who hate us. But Jesus tells his followers, don't hate back. Don't harm them in return. No, he says, do the opposite. We are to love our enemies. That's a tough task that the Lord God gives us. To love our enemy is to extend mercy to them. To love someone who has harmed us means we have to forgive them. And to forgive is also to extend mercy. So, Gems and other young people, think about maybe there's a kid at school you have to forgive, or even a sister or a brother. That's tough to do. It's not only tough for you as young people, it's tough for us as adults to forgive those who've harmed us. The kind of life that Jesus lived and the life he's calling us to, it is hard. There's no doubt about it. To live like Jesus means we have to humble ourselves. And as Paul says, we are to seek the interests of others ahead of our own interests. He said that in verse 4. The prophet Micah wrote your Gems theme hundreds of years before Jesus came to earth. But even in Micah's day, God wanted his people to live differently than the society around them. The Israelites had a hard time being different. They had a hard time following God's rules and laws and good design for life. And even in their community, in the nation of Israel, they mistreated one another. Time and time again, they did not take care of the poor and the hungry. They competed against one another to get the best that the land had to offer. But God declared to his people they were to act justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with him. Again, to walk humbly with God meant obeying his will, obeying his ways, and not following their own path, definitely not the paths of the world around them. To be humble before God means we need to submit to him. Israel always struggled to act justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with God. That's because they were sinners. They were sinners like us. And that means we will struggle too. But God sent Jesus to earth to do what they could not do and do what we can't do. God sent Jesus to be the perfect human being and the one who would die then to pay for human sin, to pay for people not acting justly or loving mercy or walking humbly in obedience to God. God forgives us for not doing that, not acting justly, loving mercy, or walking humbly with him when we surrender in faith to the Lord Jesus. That's the good news of the gospel, that there is forgiveness from sin. There is relief from eternal wrath because of what Jesus Christ has done. That's not the end of the salvation story. That's not the end of God's goal for salvation. Because once we have been received by God and we've received forgiveness from him through Jesus Christ and faith in him, we now belong to Jesus. As Christians, we are no longer our own, but belong to Jesus in life and in death, our catechism says. That means we need to live for and to live like Jesus Christ. So how does Jesus want us to live? The short answer is like him. By acting justly, by loving mercy, and walking humbly with him. Again, that's not easy. It's very hard, in fact, in a world that doesn't like Jesus, in a world that even despises him. But if we choose to follow Jesus and walk in his example, the world will despise us too. And again, I'll say it, the world might even try to cancel us, try to exclude us from society in whatever way it seems best. But obedience to Jesus, it's infinitely more important than the approval we might get from those around us outside the church and in the world. So what can you, Gems and young people, do to live like Jesus? Well, honoring and obeying parents, as the commandments say, that is acting justly. Telling the truth, not lying, that is acting justly. You can add many more examples to what it takes to act justly in a world that is unjust. Being kind, especially to mean kids, that is showing mercy. And let me just say that doesn't mean you need to take their meanness, their abuse, tell someone so that they stop. They can help you or help get that kid to stop being mean. But we're not to hate them for it. We're not to strike them back or hit them back. And when we refuse to return anger to anger that was shown to us, then we are showing mercy. Again, very hard. Remember Jesus on the cross, or on his way to the cross, they hit him, they beat him. He didn't retaliate. And doing acts of kindness because God and Jesus has been kind to you, that is to walk humbly. Caring for people makes us turn our attention away from ourselves to other people. That takes humility or humbleness. Jesus asks his people, not only our young people, but all of us, to model his example of serving others. Not so that we can be saved or that we can earn his forgiveness. No, we are called to be servants. We are called to live like Christ because we are grateful for the saving and the forgiveness that we already have as his people if our faith is in him. So our servanthood is a response to what God has done for us in Jesus Christ. So Gems and all of us here and watching, let us act justly, let us love mercy, let's walk humbly as the Lord Jesus Christ has taught us and showed us. That is the Christian way, because it's the Jesus way. Let's pray. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that you came to earth. Of course, the most important thing you did by coming to earth was making a way for salvation to happen. You made a way for us to return back to God, from whom we were separated because of our sin. We thank you for how you did that, for being the perfect human being whose shed blood alone could pay for human sin. But you didn't come to earth just to do that. You spent many years here on earth. You grew up like we did. You entered adulthood like we did. And then you spent 3 years or so in your ministry, your formal ministry, telling the people about you, teaching the disciples who you were and what you came to do. And we thank you in those years of discipling your followers that you showed them, and because you give us your word, you now show us how we ought to live. We are to live like you. So help us to do that, Lord. If we claim that you are our Savior, then you are our Lord. We must serve you and submit to you and to your way. We confess this is hard to do. We confess that at times we fail miserably following your example. We don't act justly. We don't love mercy. We don't walk humbly with you. We pray, Lord, that you would cause us to repent from the ways we live that are not like you and your example. Help us to turn from those things and to turn to you and keep our eyes fixed on you, Lord Jesus. If we repent, you will forgive. We pray that you would fill us with your Spirit so that we will say no to the world around us, so that we will say no to selfish ambition, vain conceit. We will seek to build the church of Jesus Christ, the bride of Christ, up. But we can't do that if our focus is on ourselves. We need to look at those around us and help them, Lord, in any way we can. So give us eyes to see those who are in need. Each of us has people that you bring along in life that we can help in small ways and in big ways. You give us the means to help. So help us to be faithful, to be obedient in all we do, Lord. May we act justly, may we love mercy, and walk humbly with our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. It's in his name we pray. Amen. God gives us his word and stories of Jesus Christ and his life on earth, his ministry. He gives us this so that he can shape us and mold us to be the people he wants us to be. And our next song, The Potter's Hand, and a few verses from Have Thine Own Way, speak of that. These are songs that are songs where we commit ourselves to the Lord and ask that he would shape us and mold us to be the people he wants us to be. So let's stand when the music plays and sing these two songs.
Oh,
Just a moment, we'll come to God in our congregational prayer. Lift our joys and our concerns to Him and trust that our Heavenly Father hears us. Let's bow our heads and close our eyes and come before God in a moment of silence and seeking Him, trusting that we will find Him if our hearts look for Him and reach out to Him. Let's pray. Lord God, You are the God of compassion and love, and You have breathed into us the breath of life, and You have given us mind and will, ability and strength. But we confess that we are children of frailty because we are vessels of clay made of the earth. We acknowledge that we need You every moment, every second of our lives, as our great provider, as the one who sustains all life and sustains His creation that groans under the weight of sin. We feel that groaning, Lord. We pray for those among us who are feeling the burden of failing and frail bodies. We pray for those among us that are feeling that weight of sin in their lives, Lord. They're battling some temptation, some trial that's seeking to pull them away from You. Give them strength and courage. Let their eyes be resting on Jesus. Give them the power, Holy Spirit, to say no. To say no to whatever is tempting them and to say yes to Jesus. We pray for those feeling the burden and the weight of treatments that they are undergoing and the medical care that they need, Lord. They face every moment the reality that life is fragile, that life is fleeting. Give them strength, Lord, and above all, give them hope that rests in You. Let their trust be in Jesus Christ, the one who has conquered death. We ask, bring healing if it be Your will. By admitting that we are frail children of dust, Lord, we surrender all of our life to You, from whom it came. May we trust in Your gracious promises through our Lord Jesus Christ. Lord our God, we pray wherever we live and move and have our being, that You go with us, that You be with us. We need You. Wherever we live, You call us to serve You as a witness to Your love in our lives that we see in Jesus Christ. We pray, Lord, for all among us who are living alone, who are lonely, who feel abandoned, who are grieving the loss of loved ones. Give them Your presence and Your peace. Lord, we pray for those who are separated from family for whatever reason. Give them consolation and comfort. We pray for many in the world who are refugees, who long to go home and to live life, but that is on hold. Be near them, Lord. Speak to them Your words of love, and grace, and comfort. Let them hear of the good news of Jesus. Lord, we pray for those who live in group homes and nursing homes and other care facilities. Be near them and bring them courage and contentment, Lord. We pray for the homeless and the destitute, the forgotten ones of society. Let them receive what they need, Lord, and use us as Your people, as Your church, to get them what they need. Pray, Lord, that You'd bring all people into communities of loving encouragement and support, communities that are founded on Your word and faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord God, provider of all that we are and all that we need and have, we thank You and we bless You. And so bless us in the work that we do, whether in business or industry, in homemaking, in medicine, in healthcare, in education, in agriculture, in professional ways, in academic fields, Lord, trades, wherever You call us to serve, we are to serve You in what we do. We pray for our students, Lord, those who are in a time of education, learning. Let them too know, Lord, that they're learning about You and in Your world and to serve You one day through their knowledge and the gifts that You give them. Lord, we pray for our governments who often campaign on serving others. They say they will, but when in office, they often serve themselves or their benefactors. Let them see, Lord, that you are God and you will hold them to account for their work in the government, whether good or bad. Lord, we pray for those who are transitioning in life in terms of beginning a new career or a new stage. We pray for those who struggle in their work, those who struggle to discern your calling, wondering what is their purpose. Show them, Lord, how they can serve you and live for you. We pray for those who are seeking new or different jobs, or those who are retired or anticipating that stage in life. Go with them. Wherever we are on this journey in life, Lord, give us joy in our work, our rest, and in the time that you give us. Help us to use the gifts we have and the talents that we have to build your kingdom. So give us joy, Lord, in our lives, in the work we do, the rest, being out in your creation, spending time with loved ones. Even in the day-to-day grind, may we have joy in that, because we're working for your honor and your glory. Equip us, Lord, to live and labor in ways that promote justice and peace, mercy. Equip us all to be ministers of your peace in a world that is crying out for peace, for hope. Whatever is on our hearts, Lord, hear our prayers. Whatever we're facing, let us know that you are with us, that you, Lord Jesus, through your Spirit, walk alongside us. And so hear our prayers. We pray them in the power and the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. This time we're going to stand when the music plays. We'll sing All My Ways, a song again that is confessing that we are in the Lord's hands and we need to walk with him and see him. And after the song, we'll have the collection for the offering, which is for the GEMS ministry, and we'll have a video at that time. So let's sing All My Ways. Thank you. Why don't we let's thank them for their let's pray.
Dear Lord, thank you for all the many blessings you've given us. Thank you we could gather in your house and worship the amazing God you are. Please bless this offering to GEMS, and thank you for the GEMS leaders that taught us how to act justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with our God. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Katie, for leading us in the prayer. And again, thank you, GEMS and cadet leaders, GEMS leaders for, well, we can thank the cadet leaders too, for your work and your ministry this year. And yeah, you, good pictures to remind us of the ministry of helping that school in Zambia. So you certainly learned how to act justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with the Lord through that gift of service. So thank you for that and providing that opportunity for us as a congregation to help those in need. So why don't we all stand together? We'll receive a blessing from God before we head out and sing our final song. as you go into the rest of this day and the week that lies ahead, go with the Lord's blessing. May the Lord make your love increase and overflow for each other and for everyone else. May the Lord strengthen your hearts so that you will be blameless and holy in the presence of our God and Father when our Lord Jesus Christ returns with all his holy ones. Amen.
Love.